In linear response history analysis procedure, there are two solution methods, the direct integration solution method, and second is the modal superposition solution, and that one is also known as the modal response history analysis procedure. So in this session, first session for today's class, we will discuss the difference between modal superposition solution and the direct integration solution. The summary is that in the direct integration solution, we directly solve the uncoupled equation of motion using the step-by-step direct integration method, and we get the solution and dynamic response of the multiple degree of freedom system. So our target is to solve this equation, mass matrix times u dot dot vector plus damping matrix times u dot vector plus k matrix times u vector is equal to some applied loading, and it can also be the ground shaking case. So for our case now, since we are studying the earthquake response of multiple degree of freedom systems, so it will be minus mass matrix times one vector influence vector times ug dot dot function, which is basically the ground acceleration function. So we want to solve this equation, and the first solution method is that we use numerical integration technique to solve this equation. This is a coupled equation, a matrix equation, and it can be only solved simultaneously using step-by-step numerical integration solution methods. The second solution method is the modal superposition method. We have already discussed that in the context of applied dynamic loading in the structural dynamics course, but now here we will just repeat the same exercise for ground shaking, for any ground motion ug dot dot. So in this modal superposition solution, it is based on the concept of uncoupled equations of motion. That what we basically do is that we uncouple these equations. If we are solving an n degree of freedom system, we decompose this coupled equation, matrix equation, into n equations, n separate equations. Each equation can be solved independently, and we solve all of those n equations separately and then combine them, combine the response to get the total response. So this is the basic idea of the uncoupling of the equations of motion. That instead of directly solving them using step-by-step numerical integration, we basically decompose this coupled matrix equation, big equation, into many equations which can be solved easily, independently, one by one. So the basic idea is that we solve the uncoupled equation of motion for each significant mode. The response of each mode is represented by a single degree of freedom system. When we uncouple these equations of motion into n equations, each of that equation looks like the equation of a single degree of freedom system. So it is like we are decomposing a multiple degree of freedom system, which has n degrees of freedom, into n single degree of freedom systems. So each mode is represented mathematically by a single degree of freedom system, a hypothetical single degree of freedom system, which can be solved independently, and then we can sum the dynamic responses of each modal single degree of freedom system to get the dynamic response of total multiple degree of freedom system. I will explain what I really mean by these words, uncoupling of the equation of motion, in next few slides. Now, these two are the solution methods for linear response history analysis. There is another method which is also based on the concept of uncoupling of equation of motion. But that method is a simplified form of modal response history analysis. We can consider it as a static version of the modal response history analysis. And that method is called as the response spectrum analysis procedure. It shares the idea of the uncoupling of equations of motion with the modal response history analysis. it is also based on the same concept. But there is a difference, and that difference is that here in the model response history analysis, we actually solve each of these n equations in time domain. So each single degree of freedom system is solved for the ground motion, just like the dynamic analysis of a single degree of freedom system. And then we combine the responses in time domain to get the fluctuating dynamic responses of multiple degree of freedom system. But instead of doing this, in the response spectrum analysis, we use a kind of a shortcut. And that shortcut is the use of response spectrum curve. And we know already that curve from the structural dynamics course, that for example, the peak displacement response, which is also sometimes called as the spectral displacement, can directly be picked for each single degree of freedom system if its time period is known. So we already have that curve for our earthquake for any UG dot dot, for UG dot dot, and for a given damping ratio. We can plot this curve, which is called the response spectrum analysis, response spectrum curve, and it directly gives us the peak response on y-axis for each possible single degree of freedom system or for each time period on x-axis. So what we can do is that if we know already that we have decomposed the multiple degree of freedom system into n single degree of freedom systems, each single degree of freedom system, which is basically representing a particular vibration mode of the multiple degree of freedom system, each single degree of freedom system will have its own time period. So we can apply the same curve on each single degree of freedom system separately. So if we have the first mode time period T1 here, we can pick its peak displacement. We have T2, the second single degree of freedom system, we can again pick the peak displacement. T3, we can pick the peak displacement. So for each single degree of freedom system, hypothetical single degree of freedom system, instead of solving the complete equation in time domain, what we can do is that we can directly pick the peak response from response spectrum curve. And then we can combine them statistically from each mode can be combined. The response can be just combined and get the total response. So this is a kind of a shortcut which we apply, that instead of solving the complete equation in time domain and performing the dynamic analysis for each mode separately, we directly pick the peak response from response spectrum and then combine the response to directly obtain the total peak response of multiple degree of freedom system. So response spectrum analysis is a kind of a static analog, because it converts response spectrum curve converts the dynamic problem into a static problem. So here we directly pick the peak response of each significant mode represented by a single degree of freedom system. So if we are solving a 3 degree of freedom structure, we basically first decompose into 3 single degree of freedom systems, and then we apply the response spectrum curve for each single degree of freedom system separately, pick the peak response, and then approximately combine those peak responses to get the peak response of multiple degree of freedom system. Because we don't know that each of the peak response for each mode will occur at the same time or not. So therefore, we cannot directly sum them. We have to just combine them statistically, approximately. For example, one of the way to combine the peak responses is called SRSS, square root of the sum of squares, which means that you just square the peak responses, then sum them and take its under root to get a resultant or combined peak response. So this is the summary of the direct integration solution versus model response history analysis procedure. And then the model response history analysis procedure also shares the basic concept or basic idea with the response spectrum analysis procedure also. So the summary is that response spectrum analysis procedure as well as model superposition method, they consider the contribution of more than one mode in the dynamic response of multiple degree of freedom systems. And the direct integration solution is not based on the idea of mode shapes. It directly provides us the combined peak responses as well as the time history responses, history of each response directly. So first we will discuss the modal superposition solution method, which is also known as the modal response history analysis procedure. So we know that this is our equation of motion, and this is the coupled equation of motion. By coupled, I mean that we cannot simply multiply the first row of the matrices with first column of the vector, column vector, and then we take out one equation and we can solve it independently. This is not possible here because the K matrix, C matrix, and M matrices, these matrices may have off-diagonal terms which cause coupling in this equation. So this matrix equation actually is coupled. Now, how we can uncouple it? The basic idea is that we use mode shape matrix. This phi matrix, capital phi matrix, is called the mode shape matrix, and it is basically a matrix which have each of the mode shape as a column. So if we are solving a 3-degree of freedom system, and it will have obviously three mode shapes, so each of these three mode shapes can be just combined in a matrix as columns, and therefore that will become the mode shape matrix capital phi. The idea is that if we use this mode shape matrix as a transformation matrix to convert structural displacement vector into generalized coordinates, so we know that any vector can be written as or can be converted or transformed into any other vector. So for example, we can write u of t vector, which is the structural displacement vector, as capital phi matrix times any other q of t vector. So we basically invoke this assumption that we have converted u of t into another q of t. U of t is unknown at the start, which is the solution of this main equation. Similarly, q of t is also unknown. So it's just a matter of converting one unknown or writing one unknown as another unknown, as a multiplication of something which is known and another unknown. So we can simply convert or transform u of t into another q of t, which is also unknown, but use this mode shape matrix as the transformation matrix. So phi matrix is basically used to convert from u to q. U is the physical coordinates. We know that they have a specific meaning, and those meanings is that each entry in this u of t vector is the story displacement in our discrete multiple degree of freedom system. Or each entry is basically the displacement corresponding to a degree of freedom, a particular degree of freedom. But q of t we don't know. Q of t are called generalized coordinates, and these are not the story displacements because we have converted those story displacements or displacements of each degree of freedom into another unknown. We multiply it with a known matrix and write it as a product of a known matrix and another unknown. So Q of t are not story displacements. They are some unknown generalized coordinates. So this is our basic transformation equation which we will be using, and the benefit of this transformation we will see in next slide, that our equation of motion will be uncoupled when we apply this transformation as well as the orthogonality property of this mode shapes. So we can solve those uncoupled equations separately. Each equation will be like the equation of a single degree of freedom system, a hypothetical single degree of freedom system. So we can effectively decompose an n degree of freedom system into n separate single degree of freedom systems. And if we solve those n separate single degree of freedom systems, get the q of t for each single degree of freedom system, and use the same equation back again to convert from q to u, and that u will be our final solution. So this is the basic idea. And one more concept which I will be invoking or using in this uncoupling of the equation of motion is the orthogonality property. And let's revise it quickly. Orthogonality property simply says that phi capital phi matrix transpose into mass matrix into capital phi again is a diagonal matrix, and each entry of this diagonal matrix is called modal mass, and we represent that as mu. So mu 1, mu 2, mu 3 up to mu n, and all the off diagonal terms will be 0. This is the basic idea. So this is a diagonal matrix. So we will make use of this idea or this orthogonality property. Similarly, if we replace this M with K matrix, again the resulting product will be a diagonal matrix. In that case, each entry will be basically mu into omega, for example, mu 1 into omega 1 square, mu 2 into omega 2 square, up to mu n into omega n square. And this quantity is called modal stiffness. And all the off diagonal terms will be 0, even if we have K matrix in the middle. So this is the property which we will be using to actually find a way, a classical way to solve this equation, without invoking any further assumption, because you know the step-by-step numerical integration method, they are based on invoking several assumptions. For example, piecewise linear assumption, for example, linear acceleration between time t and t plus delta t. All those assumptions are not required because we will be having a classical solution for this equation. So I will explain that solution using a four-story shear building, a 4-degree of freedom system, and it is a lump mass discrete structure, lump mass and lump stiffness structure. So u1, u2, u3 and u4 are the story displacements, and let's assume that it is subjected to ground displacement ug. It is a function of time, obviously. So ground displacement is represented by ug, and u1, u2, u3, u4, or in fact u vector is basically representing the structural displacement, the relative displacement between ground and structure. The total displacement, if you want to write, u total will be ug plus story displacement. Ug will be a constant displacement, which is ground displacement. So the base of the structure is basically having ug, and on top of ug you have the structural displacements also. So we can write it like one vector times ug plus u vector, which is the structural displacement. So this is structural displacement. We can also, in matrix form, vector form, we can write it as u total is equal to one vector, a vector containing all entries as one, ug of t plus u of t. So ug of t will be given, u of t is unknown. One vector is also sometimes called as influence vector. Its general form is called influence vector, and it basically is used to only excite those degrees of freedom which are in the direction of ug. So in our case, we have all 4 degrees of freedom in the direction of ug. So all 4 will be excited by the application of ug. So we have 1, 1, 1, 1. Ug is added to all of the degrees of freedom. If we had, for example, 1 degree of freedom which is in vertical direction, that would be included in this u of t vector. But ug will not be exciting that degree of freedom because that is in vertical direction and ug is in horizontal direction. So the corresponding entry in the influence vector will be 0 for that particular degree of freedom. So if we take double derivative, because we will be using it in our equation of motion, so therefore we can take double derivative. So this equation will be u total dot dot is equal to influence vector, a constant vector, times ug dot dot plus u dot dot. So this is structural acceleration, and this is ground acceleration. Obviously, for a particular analysis, this will be given. This will be our basic input in the analysis. And u dot dot and u dot and u of t will be our main unknowns. So let's explain the idea of this uncoupling of the equation of motion, how we can actually make use of that idea. This is our governing equation of motion for ground motion case. We know already that the acceleration used in the inertial term in the equation of motion will be u total, but for the damping and elastic restoring force it will be structural displacement, and u total can be written as influence vector into ug dot dot plus u dot dot. We can put that here, and then we can take one term on the other hand side, which is ug dot dot, and then we have this equation. This is our now standard form of the governing equation of motion for a multiple degree of freedom system subjected to ground motion ug dot dot. Now let's invoke that assumption or transform the u dot dot u of t vector into phi matrix times q of t. Let's use that transformation. Phi is defined here. It is a matrix containing the all the four mode shapes. Q is a vector which is unknown, q1, q2, q3, q4, corresponding to u1, u2, u3, u4. But now q1, q2, q3, q4 are not story displacements. This is very basic or key concept in this transformation. Never think of this q1, q2, q3, q4 as story displacements. U1, u2, u3 and u4 are story displacements. Now let's, for the purpose of further explanation, let's write this in the matrix form, this transformation here maybe. Let's write it. I am writing u1, u2, u3 and u4. All four are the functions of time, obviously. This is basically my u vector, is equal to a matrix. Now each matrix, is this matrix is basically phi1, this is phi2, this is phi3 and this is phi4, times q1, q2, q3, q4. Q1, q2, q1, q2, q3 and q4. These four entries will also be the function of time, these generalized coordinates. Now let's write u1, u1 of t. Now that will not be simply phi1 times q1. It will be basically all four q1, q2, q3 and q4 will combine in different proportions when they are multiplied with the first row. They will be combined to make u1. So basically it is phi1, the first entry of phi1 into q1, plus the first entry of phi2 into q2. Okay, so let me write it phi 1 1, phi 2 1, plus phi 3 1. 3 1 means that first entry of the third mode shape into q3, and similarly q4 1 into q4. So which means, and obviously q1, q2, q3, q4 will be the function of time also. So which means that q1, q2, q3, q4 cannot be story displacements. They are generalized coordinates and they combine in different proportions depending upon mode shapes to make first story displacement u1. Similarly u2 can also be written. So q1, q2, q3, q4, they combine in different proportions to make each story displacement. They are not separate story displacement. So this 1, 2, 3, 4 shouldn't be confused with the story numbers. Okay. So this is the basic transformation. Let's put that in the governing equation of motion. So wherever we had u dot dot, we replace it with phi into q dot dot. Here we had u dot vector, velocity vector, structural velocity vector. We have phi into q dot. Phi is constant matrix, so therefore the derivative with respect to time will only go to q of t. And here we had u of t, so therefore we have k into phi into q. And on the right hand side we have the same term. Now we multiply it with phi, capital phi transpose, to basically bring it to a shape where we can apply the orthogonality property. So therefore we multiply the whole equation with capital phi transpose. So here we have capital phi transpose, phi transpose here, and also phi transpose here on the right hand side also. Now let's apply the orthogonality property. We now know that this whole product is a diagonal matrix with the modal mass in the diagonal. Since we are assuming a four degree of freedom structure here, so we will have 4x4 matrix, and in the diagonal we will have four modal masses, mu1, mu2, mu3, mu4 into q dot dot. This whole product, we assume that we are having the classical damping, so therefore this whole product will also be a diagonal matrix. So each of the entry will be 2 xi mu into omega, and off diagonal terms will be 0. And this whole product will also be a diagonal matrix with each entry as the modal stiffness, mu1 into omega 1 square up to mu4 into omega 4 square into q of t. And let's, for the purpose of simplicity, we define this whole product as phi transpose into m into influence vector. Let's, because this will be a vector, phi transpose will be n by n, mass matrix will be n by n, in this case 4x4. One vector will be basically n by 1. So the whole product will be basically n by 1. So it means that this product is a vector, although it has matrices in it, but the product, total product, will be a vector. So let's call that vector as L vector for simplicity. And L vector will have, again in this case, it will have four entries, L1, L2, L3, L4. And we can carry out that multiplication to actually get each entry of this L1, L2, L3, L4. For any ith entry, we can take the ith mode shape transpose into M into 1. Because please remember that each mode shape is basically one column of the phi matrix. Okay, so phi matrix is composed of each mode shape arranged in the form of the columns. So we can take any ith mode shape transpose into mass matrix into 1. This will give me the ith entry of the L vector. So this is that multiplication also in the form, in that particular form. So for example, ith mode shape in this case will have 4 entries. So when we take its transpose, it will become a row multiplied by the mass matrix. This is a lump mass matrix, so there will be m1, m2, m3, 4, and all the off diagonal terms will be 0, times one vector. If you carry out that multiplication, you will see that you can write this ith entry of the L vector in this form also, that you can multiply the jth story mass with the jth entry of the ith mode shape, and you sum for j equal to 1 to 4. If you carry out that multiplication, it will become the same summation. So that's how we can calculate this L vector. It is a known vector because mode shape is known and mass matrix is known, one vector is known. So this whole L vector will be known. This is known vector. So now if we carry out that multiplication, for example, the first row is multiplied by the q dot dot vector. Q dot dot vector will be what? Q1 dot dot function of time, Q2 dot dot, Q3 dot dot, and Q4 dot dot, all function of time. So if we carry out that multiplication, first row with this whole column, obviously Q2, Q3, Q4 will become 0 because all these zeros are there, off diagonal entries. And mu1 will only be multiplied with Q1 dot dot. Similarly, the first entry will only be multiplied with the first entry. Similarly, here also the modal stiffness, the first mode's modal stiffness multiplied with the Q1 is equal to the first entry of L times UG dot dot. L1 times UG dot dot, and there will be a minus here also. So which means that if we carry out the multiplication of these matrices now, we will get each equation which will be uncoupled now, because of the off diagonal terms being 0. So the first equation will only be using the first mode's property. Second equation will only be using the second mode property because it will be mu2 into q2 only, because there will be all zero other than mu2. In third row there will be mu3 and all other entries are zero. Similarly in other two matrices also. So each equation will be the function of only one mode shape. So for any ith mode shape, I can take out the ith equation from the matrix equation. So for any ith equation, I can write this general equation. For any I, mu I into q I dot dot plus 2 xi mu into omega I q I dot plus modal stiffness into q I is equal to ith entry in the L vector times u g dot dot. So now this equation requires only phi I. The properties of phi I, for example, the ith mode shape, the omega of the ith mode shape, the xi of the ith mode shape, only these quantities are required to actually calculate qi of t. Because you know that li can be calculated in the last slide. Li can be calculated using ith mode shape. So which means that if you are given with ith mode shape, you can solve that equation, if you are given obviously with the ug dot dot also, you can solve that equation for qi. Qi can be solved from this equation independently from the second or third or fourth equation. So if we are solving a four degree of freedom, we can take out four equations. We can solve them independently to calculate q1 of t. Second equation we can solve to get q2 of t. Q3 and Q4 can also be independently calculated, because we need to solve only one equation, and this equation looks like the equation of a single degree of freedom system, because compare it with the equation of single degree of freedom system, and that is mu dot dot plus cu dot plus ku is equal to minus m times ug dot dot. Okay, so now compare this equation with modal equation for ith mode. We can see that m is replaced by mu I, so the mass of the system is replaced by modal mass. C is replaced by, basically this whole thing is C, so C is replaced by modal damping. So the damping of the system is now modal damping. Stiffness of the system is now modal stiffness. This is modal stiffness. Okay. And on the right hand side, there is minus m times ug dot dot. So this m is replaced by li. So this is not called modal mass. You can just think that now this m is replaced on the right hand side with this li. So mu I can be calculated if only phi I is given, because mu I we know already, it is what? It is the diagonal entry of the this matrix, capital phi transpose into mass matrix into capital phi again. Now capital phi is basically having all the mode shapes. So if I want only mu I only need first ith mode shape. So the ith mode shape transpose multiplied by the mass matrix multiplied by the phi I again, ith mode shape again, this will give me one number, because see ith mode shape will have the transpose of the ith mode shape will be having the order 1 cross n. Mode shape in fact have the order n by 1 and transpose will become 1 by n. Mass matrix is basically n by n. So when you carry out that multiplication, you get 1 by 1, which means you get just one number. So instead of actually multiplying the whole phi transpose into mass into phi, what you can do is for any ith mode, you can just take out one column, which is the ith mode shape, take its transpose, multiply it with mass matrix, multiply it with the mode shape again to get the mu I. So summary is that you only require phi I to get mu I. ith mode shape is required. You don't require the second mode shape to get the modal mass of first mode shape. This is what uncoupling means. Okay, that each mode is now independent from another mode mathematically. So here graph the matrix form is shown. This is the first mode shape for four story structure. It's transposed basically into mass matrix into first mode shape again. You carry out that multiplication, you will see that it can also be written in this form, because see phi I4 into M4 into phi I4 again. So it's simply mj into phi ij square j 1 to 4 in this case. For any general multiple degree of freedom system, it will be j will be 1 to n, where n is the number of stories. So when I say phi ij, it means ith mode shape and jth entry. Jth entry means that jth story. Okay. So what we can do further for this modal equation is that we can divide this whole equation with mu I, because mu I is common here, here and here also. We can take it common and shift it on the other right hand side. And let's call this Li over mu I. Let's call this number, because this is a ratio of two numbers for any ith mode. So it is a new number, a new constant. Let's call it gamma I, and we call it modal participation factor. This will be now on the right hand side of the equation, and the ith mode modal equation will become qi dot dot plus 2 xi I omega I qi dot plus omega I square into qi, because mu I is taken common, and on the right hand side we replace Li with gamma I. So this is modal participation factor, and it is now defined as the ratio of Li and mu I. So mathematically we can write it as phi I transpose into m into I, this whole thing is Li, and phi I transpose into m into again phi I, that is mu I. So again, but this gamma is also the function of only the ith mode shape. If you are given with the ith mode shape, you can calculate this gamma. So this final form of the uncoupled equation of motion for a single degree of freedom system, a hypothetical single degree of freedom system, this is uncoupled form, and this can be written for any I, where I is 1 to n, n is the number of degrees of freedom, and in this example we have 4 degrees of freedom for the purpose of demonstration only. So which means that the coupled equation of motion now is decomposed into 4 equations, I equal to 1 to 4, and we are given with phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, phi 4 up to phi 4. We already know from eigenvalue analysis omega 1, omega 2, omega 4. We are given with the xi I, xi 1, xi 2, xi 3, xi 4. So all 4 modal quantities are given or calculated earlier. Those can be used to solve these 4 equations for any given ug dot dot, and we can calculate finally q1, q2, q3, q4. This is our main unknown in the modal coordinates. And once q1, q2, q3, q4 are known, we can take back the solution again to u coordinates using the same transformation equation, which is u of t is equal to capital phi into q of t vector. Now q of t vector is known or calculated by solving these modal equations one by one, and the capital phi is also known. So we can carry out this multiplication again to calculate finally u of t, which was our main unknown. So this is the classical solution for multiple degree of freedom system equation using the idea of uncoupling of mode shapes, which was possible because of the orthogonality property of mode shapes. Now think of this equation, or for example, let's talk about the top equation, this one which I encircled, first one. Think of it as a single degree of freedom system. For example, if we are given with a single degree of freedom system with mass equal to mu I, stiffness equal to mu I into omega I square, okay, and it is subjected to ground shaking, which is L I into UG dot dot, okay. So basically, we can think of this equation as this single degree of freedom system. This is a hypothetical single degree of freedom system. It has also a damping of xi I. It is hypothetical single degree of freedom system, but it is actually representing the ith mode's response in the total dynamic response of multiple degree of freedom system. Ith mode's contribution towards the total response. Now, one more thing is that this simplified form, this one, we now know that this single degree of freedom system equation, we can take the mass out because this can be written as mu dot dot plus 2m omega xi into u dot plus k can be written as m omega square into u of t is equal to minus m times ug dot dot function of time. So now if I take out the mass common, basically I cancel the mass, the equation reduced to u dot dot plus 2 xi omega into u dot plus omega square into u is equal to minus u g dot dot. Okay. Now let's compare that equation of single degree of freedom system with this equation on the bottom. Left hand side is exactly same if we replace ui with qi, u with qi. But on the right hand side, we have an additional factor which is multiplied by u dot dot. In the original single degree of freedom equation, it is not there. It is just minus ug dot dot. But on the right hand side of the modal equation, we have gamma I into ug dot dot. So gamma can be, it can be thought of as a modifier which basically modifying your ug dot dot or applied ground shaking, and then it is applied. So basically, when I say that this hypothetical single degree of freedom system is applied with a modified ground motion, I should actually write gamma I here. So gamma I into ug dot dot is a modified ground motion which is applied to our modal single degree of freedom system if we want to map it exactly as a single degree of freedom system. So this gamma is an additional factor which is now included in the equation on the right hand side when we compare basically the modal equation with the simple single degree of freedom system equation. And it will have its role also because now it is a multiplier which is modifying the ground shaking on the right hand side. So the solution will also have its role. It will modify the solution also. So we will basically calculate gamma I for each mode using this equation. And then we multiply that number here in each mode's equation with ug dot dot. And then we solve that equation for each I. Now once we have this equation on the bottom for each I, we have two options. One is that we solve this equation in the time domain using, let's say, step-by-step direct integration. Let's apply the step-by-step direct integration or Duhamel's integral or any other method which we can apply to solve for ug dot dot. So let's, first option is that we solve it in time domain directly, just like the dynamic analysis of a single degree of freedom system. This will be our default choice. If we do that, we can one by one calculate q1, q2, q3 and q4 by putting I equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. So the overall q vector is calculated. And if it is calculated, now multiply it with phi matrix again to calculate u of t vector. That is our final solution. And in that case, if we do that, we will get each story displacement's complete time history. because u of t vector is each entry of it is basically a time history. U1, U2, U3, U4, each will have the complete time history. So this will become a dynamic analysis, a classical solution of dynamic analysis, if we do that. And if we do that, this becomes our modal response history analysis, that we solve each modal equation just like the dynamic analysis of a single degree of freedom system, calculate the whole Q vector, and then again bring the solution back to U vector. This will become our modal response history analysis. So it's a dynamic analysis using the idea of mode shapes. It's a forced vibration response using the idea of mode shapes. Mode shape itself is a product of the free vibration response, but it has a peculiar property, orthogonality property, which makes them useful in actually calculating the forced vibration response also. So the first option is, option one, is solve the uncoupled equation of motion for each significant mode. Obviously, if you are doing it for like multi-story building having hundreds of degrees of freedom, you cannot calculate or solve hundreds of modal equations, because we know that the total dynamic response have the contributions only from first few vibration modes, first few significant vibration modes. So maybe 5, 6, 7, 10 modes, those 10 equations can be solved to get the overall response. So the first option is, I repeat again, that you calculate Q of t and then you sum the dynamic responses to get the dynamic response of multiple degree of freedom system. Why I say sum the dynamic response? Because once you again bring the solution back to U of t, when you apply the same equation again by after calculating Q of t, what you are actually doing, you are summing the response for each mode separately and calculate the total response. How? Because U of t will be what? U1, U2, U3, U4 in this case. This will be first mode shape, whole mode shape, second, third, and fourth, multiplied by Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. Q3, Q4. And obviously they will be function of time because we solve using step-by-step integration method or Duhamel integral, whatever, but we actually solve the dynamic equation of motion. Now let's write U1 of t will be what? U1 of t will be, again, as I written earlier also, it will be first entry of the first mode shape, phi 1 1, times Q1. So phi 1 1 times Q1 of t plus, again I repeat, plus phi 2 1 into Q2 of t plus phi 3 1 into Q3 of t plus phi 4 1 into Q4 of t. This whole equation will make actually U1 of t. Similarly, you will write a separate equation for U2, U3 and U4. So basically you are adding the contribution of Q1, contribution of Q2, Q3, Q4, you are adding them to finally make U1. So the first story displacement is contributed by all four Q's. Second story displacement will be contributed by all four Q's depending upon this mode shape vectors, their entries, their values. So this is what I mean by, I sum the dynamic responses of each mode to get the total response. So total response is U1, U2, U3, U4, and modal responses are Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. So when you apply that transformation, you automatically sum them to get the total response. So there is no need of modal superposition method or approximately combining the modal responses, because you have the complete history of modal responses. So this Q1 is, let's say, the earthquake which we solved it for was 40 seconds. So this Q1 will be a 40 second history, which is stitched on top of Q2 40 second history, which is stitched on top of Q3 40 second and Q4 40 second histories. So all 40 second histories of Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4 will be multiplied by phi 1 1, phi 2 1, phi 3 1, phi 1, 4 1, and then they will be summed directly second by second, time instant by time instant. They will be directly stitched on top of each other to get the time history of u1 of t. So this is the summary of the modal response history analysis. The linear time history analysis, but the solution method is the modal response history analysis. The second method, which shares the same idea, although we are currently not discussing that, it is a separate method, and I have a separate lecture series on response spectrum analysis procedure. But I want to discuss here in 2-3 more slides so that you actually understand the difference between these two. The second method is response spectrum analysis procedure, and the second option after getting this equation, after getting this modal equation on the bottom, the second option was that we don't solve this equation. We now get the idea that this equation is the equation of a single degree of freedom system. And on single degree of freedom system, we can apply the response spectrum concept. So why not, instead of solving this equation using step-by-step direct integration or Duhamel integral or any other method, why not we directly apply the response spectrum on this, to this equation? That this equation is the equation of this single degree of freedom system, and this single degree of freedom system have a time period which is given, omega I is given. This can be converted into time period Ti. So why not we use this Ti in the response spectrum and directly pick the peak value of Qi. Peak value of Qi can be directly picked from the response spectrum against Ti, which is given. And response spectrum can also be generated for Ug dot dot and can be used. So the second option is this one, that we directly pick the peak response, which is the Qi max, because we wanted to calculate Qi of t. But instead of Qi of t, why not we directly pick the peak value from response spectrum by considering each mode as a single degree of freedom system. And once we get Q1 max, Q2 max, Q3 max, Q4 max, instead of directly adding those maximum values, because they will not occur at the same time. Q1 max may have a different 40 second signal. Q2 max, Q2 of t will have a different fluctuation. Q3 of t will have a different. So here in the modal response history analysis, here we directly add them because we have the complete 40 second fluctuation. So we directly apply the same equation. But here in the response spectrum, we don't have Qi of t. We don't calculate that. We directly pick its peak number. This is the expected peak value from the whole 40 second, directly picked from the response spectrum curve. Similarly, Q2 max, Q3 max, Q4 max. So we cannot now add them just like this one here. We cannot apply this equation now. So what we can do, we approximately combine them. We say that, okay, Q1 max square plus Q2 max square plus Q3 max square plus Q4 max square, and then we take its under root. This will give me a resultant Q max, a resultant value which will be less than their direct summation, but it will be representing an approximate combined Q, because I know already that these maximum values will not occur at the same time. So we cannot directly add them to get the maximum Q. So we approximately combine those peak responses directly obtained from the response spectrum to get the peak response of multiple degree of freedom system. So basically we get an approximate peak response in this method, and we don't get the complete time history 40 second of U of t. So using this Q max, we approximately get U max. How I will explain the in the next slide. So we get the u max, and this is obviously this is approximate. This is not exact. So this is an assumption which is used in the response spectrum analysis. But the benefit of using that assumption is that we don't have to actually solve each mode's equation. We directly apply the concept of response spectrum mode by mode separately, and the dynamic problem is converted into an approximate static problem, right? So this becomes our response spectrum analysis if we do the second option, option number two, after getting the uncoupled equations of motion, after understanding that each mode can be seen as a single degree of freedom system separately. Hypothetically, obviously, each mode can be mathematically described as a single degree of freedom system separately. So this is the basic difference between modal response history analysis and response spectrum analysis. Before I continue with the modal response history analysis, which is our topic for today, let me quickly have a quick overview of the response spectrum analysis procedure also. This option number two, let's discuss it briefly before going back to our main topic. So a response spectrum analysis procedure, as I explained, that once we get this modal equation, we say that the maximum deformation in this ith mode is qi max. Instead of getting qi of t, directly get qi max. And how we get that? We apply the response spectrum. We know that response spectrum is another form of the earthquake ground motion. What we do is that we convert this acceleration time history into the maximum response on y-axis, in this case spectral displacement, peak displacement, and time period on x-axis. So we basically run the dynamic analysis hundreds and thousands of times for each time period single degree of freedom system, pick the peak value from the response and plot that curve. This curve will be obviously for a particular damping ratio. So we directly have a curve from which we can pick the peak value for our case. But one difference is, as I explained in the last few slides also, that if you compare this modal equation with the equation of single degree of freedom system, you have this extra mu, this gamma I symbol on the right hand side. So therefore, whatever peak response you will pick from the response spectrum curve, which is the spectral displacement of the ith mode SDIE, you multiply that with gamma I also, because this is linear analysis. If the ground motion is modified or multiplied by a factor, the response will also be multiplied by the same factor. This is linear analysis. So whatever, for example, for any TI, you pick for any ith mode, you pick this SDI directly from the response spectrum. You have to multiply it with gamma I also, because that was being multiplied with the ground shaking. So the original response spectrum is for this equation, u dot dot plus 2 xi omega into u dot of t plus omega square into u of t is equal to minus ug dot dot and no gamma here. Okay, since the original response spectrum is constructed from this equation, therefore whatever value you will pick from for a particular ith mode peak response SDI, you will also multiply gamma I here. So qi max is gamma I into SDI, where SDI is coming from spectrum directly. Gamma I is calculated already. And now let's convert this qi into u coordinates. And that also will be approximately converted. And that is that you will use the mode shape, ith mode shape. You multiply it with the ith mode shape to convert it into ui max. Now this ui max is not the actually total story displacement. It is the ith mode's contribution in the story displacement. Okay. So SDI is determined from elastic response spectrum. at ti and xi i, okay, ith modes time period and ith modes damping ratio. Similarly, since you can pick the story displacements or spectral displacement and convert it into story displacement, you can also write the interstory drift ratio, upper story displacement minus lower story displacement. Obviously, upper will be upper story ordinate of the ith mode shape, and lower story ordinate when you subtract them, and then that will become story displacement, interstory drift. Basically, it is interstory drift. If you divide it with the story height, then it become interstory drift ratio. So one very important conclusion or result here: since we have used the same transformation ith mode, we multiplied to get the ith mode's contribution. Now this is not u vector. This is not the total u vector. This is basically the contribution of the ith mode in the total u vector when you multiply only the ith mode, because actual transformation equation is what? U of t, complete u of t, is the total capital phi matrix times q of t. Okay, this is the complete transformation equation. So if you apply that transformation equation, if I go back, if you completely apply that, you require basically all the ordinates of all mode shapes to actually get total u1. But if I write, for example, if I write only phi 11 into q1 of t, only if I write this first, you can say, term in that equation is equal to u1 of t. Although I know that u1 is basically the sum of four quantities, each quantity is basically the contribution of a particular mode shape into the total u1. Now u1 is what? Story displacement of the first, basically story displacement of first story. Total story displacement of first story is contributed by four modes. Each term is basically contribution of a particular vibration mode. So which means that if I use only here, if I use only the first mode or ith mode here, the u which I will get will not be total u. Total u will be basically sum, if I sum here. But instead of summing, if I only have one term, first mode shape, what I will be getting on the other side, I will be getting the ith mode's contribution in the total u. Okay, so I will be actually getting a vector which will be basically ui1, ui2, similarly ui3 and ui4. Now these four numbers will not be total story displacements. These will be contribution of the ith mode in the four story displacements. Similarly, I can use the second mode shape to get u2 max, u3 max and u4 max. So the response spectrum analysis can give you the contribution of each mode, peak value of the contributions of each mode. But the modal response history analysis gives you the total history, contribution of the total history, 40 second or whatever the duration of earthquake is, contribution of each mode in fluctuating form, and not only the peak numbers. So this is basically the meaning of this equation. Now, how we practically implement this response spectrum analysis in different commercial software and for the purpose of actually applying it to complex structures. What we can do is that what I did is, in this equation or whatever this equation, I actually calculated the story displacements. In this equation, this one which I am highlighting now, in this equation, I basically getting the story contribution of ith mode in the story displacement. We can use this to get other responses also, forces also. How? that what we can do is that we can calculate the equivalent static forces corresponding to each mode, because now we already know this ui max. Ui max is the vector containing the contribution of ith mode in the maximum story displacements. So use this vector now to calculate the equivalent static forces to be applied as applied forces, which will produce the same displacements obviously, but all the other responses, forces, moments, shears will also be calculated if we apply those equivalent static forces. So let's calculate those equivalent static forces FSI, which when applied to the structure produce the same displacements as UI max. And one more thing is that this UI max will have the same shape as the mode shape, because xi I, gamma I and STI are constants. These two are constants for one particular mode. So which means that UI max, if it is first mode, UI max will be the first mode's contribution. So it will look like this, that if this is your structure and it has story masses, let's say four story building, so the total U vector will be like this, maybe like this. Let me draw it, maybe like this. So this is total U, capital U of T. But from U of T, UI max, U1 max may look like this. This is U1 max. It will have the shape of the first mode. U2 max will have the shape of phi2, because here it will be phi2. So U2 max may look like this, second mode. So this is U2 max. The maximum contribution, basically the contribution of second mode to the maximum U. Okay. So sorry, this should not be U of T. This should be U max, capital vector of U max, total U. U3 max will be like third mode, like this. The contribution is even less. But when you take the SRSS, this is U3 max. Now let's take the SRSS of U1, U2, U3, U4 at, let's say, roof. At roof level, you say U1 max plus U2 max, basically their square, plus similarly up to U4 max square, and take under root, this is U max, and this is what you will get at each level. So this is this line, this double line which I am now highlighting. This is the final U max. Okay. Sorry. This will be the U max. This line. The final line, which is basically the combination or SRSS of all three or four modes, whatever number of modes you are using. So we have the contribution of each mode displacement in the total displacement, in the total story displacement. And we use this information to actually calculate the equivalent static forces for each mode, for any ith mode. So let's calculate FSI, hypothetical equivalent static forces, which when applied statically will produce UI max. UI max we have already calculated from a pseudo-dynamic analysis, from RSA. So let me write this as from RSA or pseudo-dynamic analysis. Why pseudo-dynamic? Because this is not actual dynamic. We have actually used the idea of response spectrum to directly somehow get this UI max. So let's multiply it with the K matrix, which is already available, and calculate hypothetical equivalent static forces. Then apply those forces as applied loading for each mode separately and get all the responses for each mode separately. And since these are the maximum forces, because they are calculated from UI max, so these are the maximum forces, and all the responses which this force will produce, for example, bending moment in beams, shear force in beams and columns, all those responses will be maximum responses for that particular mode only FSI for that ith mode. Okay, so and then all the responses can be SRSS at the end. For example, shear force in a beam, if four modes are being used in the analysis, that shear force can be extracted four times. First, the first FS1 is applied, then FS2 is applied, then FS3 is applied, and then FS4 is applied. Four times the forces are applied and four times the responses are extracted, and then they are combined either using SRSS or any other combination rule to finally get the total response. So UI max can be put as gamma I into phi I into SDI. We have already know it from the last slide that this is equal to gamma I into phi I into SDI, where SDI is directly coming from response spectrum. Phi I, gamma I are calculated already. K is there already. And now we apply the eigenvalue equation, where we know that K into phi I is equal to omega I square into m into phi I. This is the eigenvalue equation we are already familiar with. So K into phi I is replaced by omega I square into m into phi I. Okay. So this is gamma I into omega I square into SDI into mass matrix into phi. So now the equivalent static forces of the F of the ith mode. Now this is a F vector. Our case, it will have four entries. Basically, it will have four forces for any ith mode. They are calculated as a function of SDI. So all other things are known, which means that if the response spectrum is given to the structure, SDI can be taken out or picked corresponding to the TI for ith mode, and that SDI can be put in this equation to get FSI. Okay, so the displacement response spectrum can be directly used to calculate FSI for each mode. Okay, if you want to use the acceleration response spectrum, then you know that acceleration, spectral acceleration is omega square into SD. So you can simply put in this equation as SD can be put as SA over omega square, or you can also use this equation FSI is equal to gamma I into M into phi I into SAI, because from this equation here, omega I square into SDI will become SAI. Okay, and all other three things are there already. So this is the final equation you will be using to actually get the equivalent static forces of any ith mode if you want to use the acceleration response spectrum. So then no need to get the displacement response spectrum. What you do is simply pick the SAI corresponding to TI, pick SAI, and SAI can be put here from response spectrum, and then all three things are known already, then you calculate the FSI. FSI are the forces which, when applied statically to the structure, will produce same displacement as UI max, which you have calculated already here. So now you think in an overall sense that what you have actually done is that you have converted a purely dynamic problem into a static problem. And you have calculated those forces which, when applied statically, will produce the same displacement which you have already calculated using a pseudo-dynamic method. Okay, so FSI will have the same variation or same shape as the phi I. Why? Because all other three things are constants. For a particular mode, SAI will be a constant number. Mass matrix and gamma are constants. So which means that the first mode's equivalent static forces will be of the same shape as the first mode. Second mode's forces will have the same shape. Obviously, the first mode forces will be all, let's say, like this. They will be decreasing as you go down, and all will be in the same direction. Second mode shape, forces will be like this. Some will be on the left, some will be on the right, because they will deform the structure in the second mode shape. They are calculated from U2 max, and U2 max have the same displacement as the second mode. These first FS1 are calculated from U1 max. Similarly, third mode shape forces will be like this, that first they will be towards the right hand side, then left hand side, then again on the right hand side, because they are calculated based on U3 max. Okay, so you can carry out these analysis for maybe 5-10 modes, and you extract all the responses from this analysis separately, this analysis separately, this analysis separately. So if you carry out the analysis for 3 modes, it's as though you are actually carrying out the static analysis 3 times, and all the responses are extracted one by one from 3 analyses and then are combined statistically to get the total response. This will become your response spectrum analysis. See, so in short, this analysis is a static analysis. Actually, it is a static analysis because we have applied the effective equivalent static forces statically to the structure. But those forces are calculated using the idea of response spectrum curve, which is actually calculated using hundreds and thousands of dynamic analysis of single degree of freedom systems. Okay. This is if the response spectrum is for a real earthquake, for a real UG dot dot. Okay. When you use this method for design, then you don't use a real UG dot dot. You actually use a smooth design spectrum. So this SAI will be coming from a smooth design spectrum if you are using this analysis for design. And this SAI will be coming from the response spectrum of a real earthquake if you want to carry out the analysis for a real earthquake. So this SAI is the spectral acceleration. Actually, it is coming from elastic response spectrum. That elastic response spectrum can be either design spectrum, it can be any spectrum. So it depends on for what purpose you are carrying out that analysis. So the model combination rules which you can use in the response spectrum analysis procedure, they can be, as I have said, SRSS. Actually, it was used originally in mechanical engineering to combine the peak responses or peak values to get a normalized or resultant peak value. Then later it was in 1980s, it was used in structural engineering in response spectrum analysis. First, Professor Edward Wilson, which is also one of the person who have carried out major developments in response spectrum analysis, he applied this procedure. In this procedure, we actually extract the peak modal response. It can be anything. It can be displacement, drift, shear force, bending moment, rotation, strain, torsion, whatever response it is. You extract it for each mode separately, take its square and sum it for all the modes, and then take the under root. It is the most widely used modal combination rule, and obviously these rules are approximate rules. I have already told you that the exact solution is that you actually apply this equation U is equal to phi into Q in the time domain for each step. This is the accurate, you can say, combination of modes, that you actually combine them in time domain. Okay, for all 40 seconds, for example, if the earthquake duration is 40 seconds, you combine all modes 40 seconds, sum them for each time instant. But if you cannot do it, you want to use a shortcut, you want to use an RSA procedure, then you have to go for these approximate combination rules. So the first one is SRSS. And before the use of SRSS, there was a time when we also used absolute sum. Obviously, it is not accurate. It is very conservative. We know that all the modes do not reach the peak value at the same time. So there is no, you can say, theoretical basis for actually directly summing them. But there was a time when we were using it. It is too conservative. Obviously, it will give you a very high number of all responses. And it sometimes can be used as an upper bound of the response. If you want to see that what is the upper bound of the response, you can directly sum them also. So SRSS was originally developed by Rosenbluth in 1951. And it is good for structures with well separated natural frequencies. If the natural frequencies are well separated, first mode, let's say 2 second time period, second mode 0.8 second, third mode 0.3 second, then SRSS is a good combination rule. But if the natural frequencies of the structure are closely spaced, for example, if the structure is not a well proportioned structure, or there are structures, for example, imagine a structure which is all comprised of RC walls and RC slab. It is not a frame structure, it is complete RC walls and RC slab. That kind of a structure will have frequencies which are closely spaced. Maybe first mode 2 second, second mode 1.8 second, third mode 1.2 seconds, like that. In such a scenario, there are other combination rules also. One is CQC, complete quadratic combination, and there are others also. For the detail of those combinations, please refer to the chapter 13 of A.K. Chopra, Dynamics of Structures, and you will find the detail of this complete quadratic combination, CQC. SRSS is the most commonly used combination rule. So the summary of this response spectrum analysis procedure is, I know that I have drifted from our original topic, which is the modal response history analysis, but I will come back to it in maybe one or two slides. Let me just conclude the response spectrum analysis procedure step by step. If you want to apply it to a structure, first you formulate M and K matrices and C matrix also using the information or estimated value of the xi I. Then you perform eigenvalue analysis, calculate Tn, omega n, phi n, formulate the capital phi matrix, which is used later. Now then compute peak modal responses of each significant mode. How you compute peak modal responses? I already explained that you use Ti and xi I to pick directly the spectral acceleration or spectral displacement if you want to use it. Then calculate the ith mode's contribution in the maximum story displacements or story drifts using these equations. Then calculate the equivalent static forces which will produce the same displacement, by the way, FSI for each mode. For example, for 5 modes, calculate FS1, FS2, FS3, FS4, FS5. Carry out the static analysis for all FSI separately. Apply those forces and calculate all the responses of the. So obviously, this will be F is equal to KU. This is the static analysis. F is equal to KU. And F is now FSI. Estimate peak response by combining peaks of the individual modal responses. Usually lower modes contribute significantly to overall response, so maybe only first few modes can be included in analysis. So for example, if you are going for a 10 story building, only go for maybe first 4 or 5 modes in each direction. If you basically go for a total of 20 modes, this will cover the 4 and 5 modes in each direction. 15 to 20 modes are enough. No need to actually include hundreds of modes, because actual 10 story building you may have hundreds and thousands of degrees of freedom. And theoretically it will have hundreds and thousands of mode shapes, but all may not contribute significantly. Only first 15-20 modes in both directions basically 4 to 5 modes in both directions, each direction will contribute significantly. So RSA basically reduces the dynamic problem into a static problem, in fact a series of static problems under FSI, equivalent static forces for first few modes. Now compare it with ELF. ELF is giving you a just one vector in which you just calculate directly that one single vector, single force, equivalent static force vector, and apply that force vector. The distribution of that force vector is similar to first mode only. So which means that all those structures which may have significant contributions from second, third, fourth, fifth modes, ELF is not an accurate analysis procedure. You have to go for RSA or modal response history analysis or direct integration solution, I mean the true dynamic analysis. RSA still retains the features of dynamic analysis. It uses these modal properties. ELF doesn't use modal properties. ELF uses only approximate time period which is calculated from an empirical formula, for example 0.1 times n. And the actual first mode time period may be significantly different from this TA. But obviously when you are using ELF, you will still use the approximate time period. You will not use the actual time period of the structure. There are some building codes which allow to use or to modify this TA if the actual time period is significantly different from the one which is calculated from this approximate formula. But RSA uses actual time periods. It actually uses the eigenvalue analysis output to actually calculate the seismic response. So RSA reduces the dynamic problem into a static problem. The dynamic part of the problem is already done while developing the spectrum. Okay, so it's like someone have already carried out dynamic analysis hundreds and thousands of times on your behalf already and directly give you the spectrum, and now you are using it directly. The direction of FSI is controlled by the algebraic sign of phi I, as I have explained earlier. The shape of FSI will be the same as the shape of mode shape. And one very common mistake which is often done when you use RSA, calculating one response from the combined peak response, combined peak of the other response is wrong. For example, you can sum all the modes to get the story displacements. Now let's say that you get the U max by SRSS after doing the SRSS. You get these four numbers for four story building, let's say. This is after SRSS. Now if you want to calculate the interstory drift ratio, you should not do this upper story minus lower story, upper minus lower from the U max. You should not do it, because that U max is already the maximum displacements calculated after SRSS from each mode. And one response from the combined peak of the other response should not be calculated. So if you want to calculate the IDR, you should calculate the UI max, U1 max separately, U2 max separately. You have these four vectors already. You calculate IDR 1 max separately, IDR 1 max separately by upper minus lower of the U1 max, upper minus lower of the U1 max. Similarly, you calculate IDR 2 max, IDR 3 max, IDR 4 max, and then take SRSS of the 4 IDR responses. That will be your final IDR max. Not directly after from the U max. Okay, so I hope that I was able to make it understand that you should not calculate one peak response from the combined response of the other, you can say combined values of the other response. IDR max should not be calculated from U max. It should be calculated at individual mode level and then perform the SRSS at the mode level to get the total response. Similarly, for example, the story shear at each floor, the final story shear from all modes should not be directly calculated by summing the FSI. You calculate story shear for each mode, then take SRSS to get the total story shear at each floor. Okay. So this is a common mistake which we do, that we calculate one peak response and then use that to calculate another peak response. This should not be performed. Each response should be calculated at the individual mode level and then take the peak, then take SRSS. So in the graphical form, if I write the response spectrum analysis, it is like a real structure was applied with total random dynamic forces. Okay. But what we did is that we decomposed that structure into T1, T2, T3, T4 using the modal analysis. And then we apply response spectrum to each T1, T2, T3 separately to pick SA1, SA2, SA3 spectral acceleration. And each spectral acceleration is used to calculate FS1, FS2, FS3. Each is applied separately to multiple degree of freedom system, the original structure, this one. Each is applied to get any response R1, R2, R3, and then those are combined using SRSS or CQC to finally get the total response. So this is the graphical form of graphical summary of the response spectrum analysis. So now let's come back to our original method or solution technique which we were studying, and that was modal RHA, and that was option one basically, not this option two which we actually explained in last few slides. And option one was that we actually solve the modal equation of motion to get QI of t, complete QI of t, not QI max, complete time history of the QI for any I 1, 2, 3, 4, and formulate the Q vector, Q of t vector. We formulate that and then we bring the, you can say, solution back to from Q to U coordinates. We transform using the same equation. So whatever Q of t we formulated after calculating Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, we multiply that with phi and then we calculate finally U of t. So this will be our modal RHA procedure. And one thing which we can do is that we can use this modal RHA to actually calculate the fluctuating responses of each mode. In RSA, we get the peak response for each mode and then we combine them. In modal RHA, we can get the fluctuating response of each mode. So for example, if any ith mode, if I get UI max from this equation, okay, which is from RSA obviously, UI max, this will be same as the peak displacement from RHA because the spectra is already based on RHA. We use the spectrum and pick the STI and we use that STI to get UI max. That UI max will match basically with the peak values of the ith mode responses calculated by RHA, modal RHA, modal response history analysis. Why? Because the response spectrum which we used is already based on the dynamic analysis. And in the modal RHA, we are actually solving that modal equation. We are actually calculating carrying out the dynamic analysis. So for any ith mode, we get UI max directly one number, okay, at any particular story level. We directly get one number from RSA, but we get total 40 second history of UI of t, function of time, from the modal RHA. This is modal RHA. Now pick that peak value from that, it will match with UI max from RSA. Why? Because this SDI is already from the dynamic analysis of single degree of freedom system. And here in modal RHA, we are actually doing that for a particular single degree of freedom system and then picking the peak value. So which means that they will match. But a big but is here that U max from modal combination rule. In RSA, what you do is that you do it for first mode, second mode, third mode, and do modal combination rule. After modal combination rule, whatever U max you will get, it will not be same as the peak displacement extracted from the combined modal response history analysis results. After in the modal response history analysis results, after you apply this equation, this original equation, and now in from the U, if you pick the peak value, if you extract the peak values, they will not match with the peak values calculated from response spectrum analysis. Why? Because in the response spectrum analysis, we are using an approximation, and that approximation is modal combination rule. This basically introduces an error in the modal in the response spectrum analysis. So this is a source of uncertainty, source of error or uncertainty in the analysis. In the modal RHA, this is not there. We actually apply this equation. So modal RHA is not only it is conceptually more superior, it also doesn't invoke this source of error. So therefore it is more accurate. It is a classical dynamic analysis. It is a classical dynamic analysis. The only source of error in the modal RHA is that when you solve the modal equation, you may use the step-by-step direct integration. And there is a source of error in that. So now when you, let's come back to our original topic and let's see in one or two slides that when we actually apply the modal RHA in ETAPS, we basically define a load case, and in the load case we select the load case type as the time history, linear time history obviously. In the time history we have four options: linear modal, non-linear modal, linear direct integration, and non-linear direct integration. You might guess already that non-linear modal and non-linear direct integration are the non-linear time history analysis. Linear time history analysis is linear modal or linear direct integration. And as the name indicates, linear modal means linear modal response history analysis. Linear direct integration means that the solution solver will directly solve the governing equation of motion using step-by-step direct integration. So if you select linear modal, then you have to select the load type. It can be a dynamic load pattern, or it can be an applied acceleration pattern. So for linear response history analysis, we will select acceleration. U1 corresponds to the global x direction, U2 corresponds to global y direction. The function will be obviously the actual UG dot dot. So here we have to actually select UG dot dot, and we will first import that UG dot dot before actually defining the load case, and then select it from that list. So here basically we have to select the previously defined function or time variation for that particular load or acceleration. So if we select acceleration, that variation will become UG dot dot. If we select load pattern, then that variation will be basically the variation of applied loading. We can also select a scale factor. Now, since we have selected the linear modal, we have to tell the software that from where you should select, you should get this omega I, phi I, ti, and xi I. All of this information we have to give to software. So the modal properties should come from the modal load case. We have to select that. And the number of output time steps and some other things. This modal damping option, this is for basically xi I. Xi I is required. So we can go for this modify show option to actually define this xi I. So all the information required to actually carry out modal RHA is provided to the software. Here UG dot dot is provided. Here modal properties are provided. and some other information, and then xi I is provided. If you go for that xi I option, modal damping, you can define a constant value of modal damping for all the modes, let's say 5% for all the modes. So xi I will become 0.05 for all modes, I equal to 1 to n. Or you can also define time period and xi value, and you can also define the mass and stiffness proportional damping. So you basically define m and k proportional damping, software will convert it into xi I and then calculate the C matrix. All of that is basically is to construct the C matrix. So if you go for let's say constant value, you can give it here. If you want to, if you select for interpolated damping by period and frequency, then you have to provide the time period and xi values, and software will interpolate between them. Third option will allow you to actually define the mass proportional coefficient and stiffness proportional coefficient, sometimes also called as alpha and beta, or a naught and a one sometimes. So these values you can define, and software will use the Rayleigh damping idea to actually construct, finally construct the C matrix. So all the information which is required in the analysis is given to the software, and software then carries out that whole thing which you have studied in last few slides. Now in the second part, let's quickly discuss the direct integration solution, the second method for linear time history analysis. Obviously, this we will not go into detail of any numerical integration method, because that we have already discussed in the structural dynamics course. But I will just quickly give you an overview of the direct integration solution methods. We have several numerical methods to determine the dynamic response using this approach. Central difference method, and then there are several Newmark method, for example, constant average acceleration method, linear acceleration method, Wilson theta method, and there are step-by-step numerical integration methods for non-linear systems also. One very important thing is that this linear model superposition method is only applicable to linear systems, f is equal to ku. But the step-by-step numerical integration methods can also be applied to both linear and non-linear systems. Okay, so when you perform this thing, actually you are carrying out non-linear response history analysis or non-linear time history analysis. But all these are for linear time history analysis. So, for example, Newmark's linear acceleration method we have already studied in structural dynamics course, and this is its final equation. That this equation is it has the form of a linear equation f is equal to ku, where this is the increment in displacement from time t and time t plus delta t. This is a modified k matrix which is defined here, and this is a modified force vector which is defined here. So you can use these equations for each time instant, step by step, and then finally get the total u vector as a result. So this k of t can be interpreted as the effective dynamic stiffness, and this p of t can be the effective load increment. So we have studied the Newmark's linear acceleration method, and we know that there are two basic approximations used in this process. And one is that C and K matrices, they remain constant during T and T plus delta T. Within a particular time increment, they do not vary, but they can vary from time increment to another time increment. So that's why they are applicable to nonlinear systems also. If the K matrix is variable, the step-by-step Newmark's linear acceleration method can handle that. So, but for linear time history analysis, we assume that they remain constant throughout the analysis, C and K. But the assumption in the analysis is that between T and T plus delta T, within a particular time increment, Even for nonlinear systems, they don't vary. This is the basic assumption in this method. And the second assumption is, as the name indicates, that the acceleration u dot dot varies linearly during the time t and t plus delta t. So all of these approximations basically induce errors. And since this method is based on step-by-step application for all time instances, so the errors may accumulate and finally the solution become unstable. So therefore, we always require those algorithms or improved algorithms which are unconditionally stable. Wilson theta method is one example of those methods which are unconditionally stable. So this is the flow chart which we basically used in the Newmark's linear acceleration method, and we started with one time instant t, and we finally calculated the increment in acceleration, velocity and displacement at t plus delta t. We add that increment to the original values to get the next time increment values, and then they are used as the starting values for the next loop. So that's how the whole calculation flow chart is actually solved step by step to calculate the total displacement solution for a particular multiple degree of freedom system. So if you go for a particular commercial software, for example in this case ETABS, so you will find different algorithms for this step by step direct integration. So if you in ETABS, if you select the time integration, linear time integration, you may select either Newmark, Wilson, collocation, HHT, or this one, Chung and Hurlburt. So there are different solution methods which use different assumptions to actually carry out the step-by-step direct integration method. HHT is the default one in ETABS. So when you use the linear direct integration solution method in the time history, linear time history analysis, you have to select load type, either it is acceleration or load pattern. You have to select the direction and the function of basically UG dot dot. The number of output time steps, delta T, this is already you are familiar with. But more importantly, these two are the additional things which you have to select. Since it is step-by-step direct integration, so you have to select the solution algorithm, HHT is default, and you have to select the damping, how the software should construct C matrix. And if you want, you can go for some advanced options also. For example, if you want to apply the ground shaking at a certain angle and not in the U1, U2, U3 global X or Y direction, then you can also give a certain angle after clicking these advanced option, and that angle can be given here. So if you go for the damping options in the linear direct integration, same options, almost similar options are there. You can either go for this constant modal damping, constant damping for all modes, or you can go for your own damping values for different time periods or frequencies, or the Rayleigh damping option you can go for. So that's how software will construct the C matrix and then finally perform the step-by-step direct integration solution method.